लता क्रिस्टी, ब्यूटीफुल वुमन हुम आई एडमायर, बोथ ब्यूटीफुल इन एंड आउट. And Lata Christie is a senior scientist with the Government of India for the past 34 years. She has completed her bachelor's with honors in electronics and communication engineering and her master's and PhD in aerospace engineering from Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore. She is the author of 6 books. Such a privilege for us to have you, Dr. Lata, and over to you.
Praise God. It's wonderful to be here with the YWCA group. And today I'm going to speak about beauty isn't serving. So, and we have a wonderful passage for that. The woman with the alabaster box. The woman with an alabaster box, this account is given in 3 places in the Bible. Mark, Matthew, and Luke. Mark chapter 14 verses 3-9 and Matthew chapter 26, 6-13 gives the same account of Jesus' anointing. But the third account given in Luke 7, 36-50 was a different anointing. We can infer from all these 3 accounts that Jesus has received 2 anointings. One at the beginning of his ministry that is given in Luke 7 and the other 2 at the end of his ministry. That same account is given both by Mark and Matthew, that is in the Passion Week, towards the end of his ministry in the week leading up to death and Passover. So today we are going to concentrate on this woman with the alabaster box at the beginning of Jesus' ministry. This is the story of a woman who had no voice, who had no rights, who was deemed sinful, outcast, but finally her dignity was restored because she came to Jesus. So we can also read of Simon, a man of good reputation and popularity. And he has invited Jesus to his house for dinner. Suddenly, we can read an uninvited woman who had a bad reputation, the reputation of a sinner, appears on the scene. She just crashes in. It's like the appearance of a beggar in a big party where full of rich men and women with grand apparels. Here, the man who called Jesus for a dinner has called many other men with great reputations, and they're all sitting around Jesus, and there she comes. The Bible says clearly she was an immoral woman. She might have made very bad choices. We don't know. The woman learned that Jesus was sitting at the Pharisee's house. So she came there with an alabaster jar of perfume. Jesus was happily reclining at the table, but she stood behind him at his feet, weeping, sobbing so much that her tears are falling down at his feet, so much enough that it could be like water covering his feet. And then she pulls out her hair and she wipes those tears. And then finally, she does it over and over again. And we can see a beautiful worship there. And finally, she takes out her alabaster box that's full of wonderful perfume and pours it at his feet. She might have broken that alabaster box and poured it at his feet. The alabaster box was very costly. You know, she might have earned her whole living to get that perfume. But today, she got a chance to pour everything at the feet of Jesus. But that Simon and other Pharisees were all looking at that woman and Jesus. They're all having in their mind, okay, this woman is a sinful lady, but Jesus is not even telling anything to her. So what is it all about? So Jesus, understanding their thoughts and looking at that incredible worship of that lady, wanted to bring out some incredible truth. So he looked at Simon and he responding to the criticism of him in his mind and tells a story. The story of 2 debtors. One debtor owned 500 denarii, the other 50. And now both of them could not pay. So the debtor had forgiven both of them. Now who would love them more? So Simon responded rightly. So Jesus was telling, it's the same way. She loved me more. So all her sins are forgiven. In this thing, you can read that Jesus is acknowledging that he knows her past. He He knows that she was a sinner. He knows everything about her. But he knows, but still loves her. That is the heart of God. When you read this passage, you will understand the heart of God. Simon, I have something to tell you. I came here as a guest. You're supposed to wash my feet. You're supposed to kiss me. In those days, as how we shake hands, they used to kiss. So you never did anything. You never loved me. You just called me just like that. But you never gave any love to me. But this one, uninvited, came here and she had put all her love on me. And now who has to be rewarded more? So that's what Jesus is telling. So he wanted to tell him that you're all not worshiping. This is not the prayer I need. But this lady who has cried so much, who has felt sad for her sins, now her sins are forgiven. Go in peace. That was the word she was waiting for. Go in peace. I know that lady's life that day would have got transformed. When lepers touched Jesus, Jesus never became leprous. They got freed of leprosy. You know, similarly, when sinners touched Jesus, Jesus never became like them, but he transformed them. He changed their life. That's what Jesus does to us. Jesus did not minimize her sins. Bible is very clear that sin ultimately leads to death. Paul said it in this way. The wages of sin is death. And the Old Testament, whole sacrificial system, everything points to that. The blood of the goat and lamb had to be shed for the remission of sins. But in the New Testament, Jesus said, no more lamb, no more goat, no more bull. It's my blood, my holy blood that will be shed. I will be hanging on a tree. Because I will be hanging, every curse of yours will be removed. Because of my blood, your sins will be forgiven. No longer you're separated from me, my daughter, because I have forgiven your sins. Now you can worship me more closely. That's what Jesus offered to her. Today he's offering to you and me to be at peace. He gave his life on the cross, on the tree. He removed every curse of us. By his blood, he removed every sin. He paved the way. Now we have a God-man sitting at the right hand of the Father, interceding for you and me. Like that day, Jesus interceded for that lady. She loved me more, so her sins are forgiven. Not like you. You are a righteous man in front of the world, but you are a hypocrite. You are not righteous in front of me. So he brought in the two distinctions. The sinner who was cleansed and the righteous man who was actually a sinner. So now here we can see the hypocrisy of the religious leaders. Jesus was bringing it into the open. So, you know, James 2:13 says, mercy triumphs over judgment. So Jesus offers mercy, forgiveness, and restoration to that lady at his feet. I want you to notice here how the situation suddenly changes. One moment before, she was a sinner and everybody looked at her with indignation. Now she has been cleansed and she goes with peace. And this is from God's side. What is from the lady's side? What she did? She rose to the occasion. She seized the Kairos moment. She used her faith and saved her life. How? She knew that Jesus was coming to the town and she ran inside. So, you know, the Greek language had two principal words. One is chronos and the other one is kairos. So chronos is all about chronological days, weeks, months, and years. So the second word is more important, that is kairos, a word that is radically different. Something deeper had to do with the quality. It's time filled with opportunity, a moment pregnant with eternal significance and possibility, a moment when we are confronted with a choice, a decision, and we need to do a potential action that brings in that deeper significance in our life, what we are going to become and what we are going to impact. So how are we seizing that Kairos moment when we are presented with such a moment? How we are responding to it? Are we responding to it with urgency and meaning? Making history has nothing to do with our ability. Making history has something to do with responding to the Kairos moment. So now coming to this story, we can see here, this lady has become a revolutionary follower of Jesus. A real follower of Jesus is always a revolutionary. They are always radicals. They follow Jesus' agenda. His agenda is very clear. First and foremost, reaching out to the lost and dying world with an one and only message that can transform someone's eternity. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life, and no one comes to the Father but for by me. So if this is the great commission that has been given to you and me. Jesus said, I came looking for the sinners and for the lost and not for the righteous. If we want to be swept up into the great redemptive drama that God is enacting on the stage of this planet, we cannot be like that Pharisee, a hypocritical Puritan, but to be like Jesus, to go in search of the lost and the broken. If we are seeking for God's kingdom, we need to devote ourselves to what God wants, what God cares about, what God wants to do it, and finding out what he is doing and willingly joining our hand with him and allowing him to do it. It means to bring our life in alignment with his agenda and letting his agenda become our agenda. The clear and foremost reaching out to a lost and dying world with the transforming message of Christ. You know, this is the service he expects, and this service is beautiful. And, you know, to get this beauty, we need to go into depth with three other beauties. So that's what my message is all about. Because 1 Corinthians 12 says that God has endowed us with the gifts of the Holy Spirit for the common good of all. He has given us supernatural ability. But if we hold on to it and forget to really become intimate with him, we will turn into making what we do for God as the foremost than what we are becoming. So what is it all about? What we can learn from this story? How to really serve God with beauty? So the first one is beauty of worship. The second, beauty of brokenness. The third, the beauty of seizing the Kairos moment. So these are the three types of beauty I'm going to speak about that will help us to become really beautiful in serving Christ. The first, the beauty of worship. Luke 11, we can read Jesus entering into a town called Bethany. And here there were two sisters, Mary and Martha, and they had a brother called Lazarus. And Jesus comes there, and Martha is so busy working on cooking for Jesus. In Luke 10:39, we can read that she was happily sitting, and Martha was getting so angry, and she comes to Jesus and she asks, Jesus, why don't you bother that my sister is not helping me? So Jesus told, only one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen the good part. Only one thing, that is to sit at my feet. So sitting before serving, it's not Mary against Martha, it is Mary before Martha. That is, you need to serve, but you need to sit at his feet before serving. So that is the most important thing, that we get lost in the busyness of the world. We get lost with our anxiety. We get lost busy running around the stuff, but we never sit at his feet. But Jesus is telling, only one thing is needed, like that woman, sinful woman who sat at my feet. I want you to sit at my feet before you serve my cause. That's what I said. It's not putting Mary against Martha. It is putting Mary before Martha. So your primary source of identity is not what you do for God. It is what you are becoming, what you become closer to God by sitting at his feet. You know, time is coming that the true worshipers will worship God in spirit and truth. That's what God is seeking about. So here, God wants someone to worship him in spirit and in truth. And God is loving that worship. How are we worshiping today? Is our worship going beyond us, beyond the ceiling? Are we just worshiping for others' sake or for the beauty of our voice? Is it meaningful? Is God liking that worship? So let's come today and kneel down at his feet and ask God, am I worshiping you really? Because this is very important. Jesus says that I want you to be here at my feet before you serve me. Because same thing David did. And David says in Psalm 27:4, one thing I ask the Lord, and that's what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord and to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord. So that's what he's asking. Even Psalm 24:3-4, who shall ascend into the hill? Who shall stand in his holy place? He who has a pure heart. So today, if we want to have that one thing to sit at his feet, we need to become righteous before God. We'll ask him to forgive us and ask for that own thing, what Paul said in Philippians 3:13-14. Brethren, I count myself as to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching unto those things which are before, I press towards the mark for the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus. Yes, this is the only one thing which we need to be at his feet, to know what he wants us to do. And so he has made us alive in Christ Jesus. We were dead in our trespasses. Today he has made us alive in Christ Jesus. And so let us respond to the fullness of grace. Let us come to Christ and ask him, Lord, I want to be intimate with you. I want to know your beauty. I want to enjoy you. I want to have a conversation with you. You know, we just come to his feet and we speak. A prayer is a dialogue. We should listen to God, what he wants us to do. So God in heaven looks at us and says, I love you. I'm giving you my grace, and let's sit at his feet and enjoy that love more than asking, I need this, I need that. So that's all about worship, to be in his presence and to tell that, God, I want this one thing, and that transforms us. So we come to his feet today. Let's come to his feet and worship. Are we like that Pharisee trying to become judgmental at others? Or are we like that sinful woman sitting at his feet, crying and worshiping him with spirit and truth? So let our hearts be torn before today with a sacrifice of praise. The second beauty of brokenness. Christ never looked at her as a sinful woman. He sees her true character. For him, her identity is in Christ. He has made her in his very own image. We don't look at people who are not like us, but Christ was not like that. He allowed everyone to touch him because everyone are made in the image of God. You know, this brokenness is very, very important. Out of brokenness, the love of God flows. That's why sometimes Christ breaks us. In my life, when I was broken terribly, I understood God allowed me to be broken so that I can understand the brokenness of somebody else. And Christ's love can be poured out through me to that person. So we all hate brokenness. We want to be in charge of our lives. We don't want to be broken. But Jesus says, through that brokenness, through breaking your alabaster box, the perfume, the beautiful worship is released. So today, if you're broken, if you're going through a season of brokenness, of sickness or affliction or weakness, pour it over to God like that lady poured her sin at the feet of God with a beautiful perfume. Let us pour it because God can use our brokenness. From our deepest pain can become the launching pad for his greatest mission. So let us not be cold. Let us not have a lukewarm relationship with Jesus. Let us not be distant to him. Today, let us fall at his feet. Lord, I need your love. I want to be with you. Some people come to church, and just like that religious leaders, they come, sit, and go. But today, God is not asking such a worship. He wants us to come to his feet and cry out and enjoy him and put our brokenness at his feet. The third, the beauty of seizing the Kairos moment. This lady had a choice, and she used that choice the best way. She ran and came to his feet, poured the alabaster box, and she enjoyed the peace given back. Yes, at various point in time, we will have countless opportunities presented to us by God to do something significant with our own and only life. God will give such Kairos moment to do something remarkable, something life-changing, even world-altering. So they are divine in nature. They are supernatural in potential and eternal in significance. It will be a moment when we are confronted with a choice. So Os Guinness says, nothing is more critical than to recognize and respond to such a moment. Christ is a transformer of culture, and he wants us to transform the lives and cultures around. The world is in need of such a transformed man or woman who can come to the center stage and become the tip of the arrow what God can use to transform the world. There are many who had missed such Kairos moment. Even at the end of Jesus' life, he looked, overlooked the city of Jerusalem, and he said, he weeps. You could not understand the time what God has come to you. Now you will know your future is going to be ruined because you did not seize that moment. They missed the Kairos moment of God coming to them. So today, let's understand the deepest level of who we are and who God says we are. Our identity begins with Christ. We are made in his very own image. We are his workmanship, and we are his stewards to do his work in this world. So let's come to him like that sinful woman, not like that Pharisee who abuses others, who talk bad about others, who judges others. But let us come with a brokenness. Let's come with worship, seizing the Kairos moment, and serve the Lord with beauty. Let's pray. Precious Father, I give this time into your hands. And Lord, I give every sister, every brother who have joined this into your hands. Lord, you're going to do something amazing in their lives, Lord Jesus. And Father, bless them richly, Father, each and everyone who are here, Father. And Lord, if they are broken, Father, use that, Lord, and make them into a transformed and revolutionary vessel for your glory, Lord Jesus. And like that sinful woman, Lord, today, let everyone, Lord, come to your feet and cry and seize their Kairos moment and understand why they are in this world, the meaning of their life, the purpose of their life. Lord Jesus, I give this time in your hands and thank you, Lord, that you have been speaking to us. We give you all the glory, honor, and praise. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
And thank you, Dr. Latha, for beautifully exposing the scriptures. And I hope we will all cling on or catch the Kairos moments that come in our lives and learn God's words all the more and love God all the more and serve God all the more.